You've got inferiority complex, you have.
Yeah, I know, that's why I play the drums. It's my active compensatory factor.
Hi, I'm Dave Stewart. Welcome to another edition of Off the Record. I've got an amazing star, literally. He's turned into a great friend, and he's also one of the most amazing drummers ever recorded. Here he is, Mr. Ringo Starr. I think, you know, we'll go in a slightly chronological order and then wander. When you were a child, you had like a year and a half kind of took out of your sort of integration with other kids by being put in hospital.
I was still integrated with other kids, but we're all sick.
Yeah, you were all sick. Well, it's very interesting because when I was a kid, I was put in hospital, and that was where somebody brought in a guitar. I'd never played a guitar before. And I learned the guitar in a hospital.
Yeah.
And similarly...
Well, actually, as the second time I was in this hospital, because I was in a long time, so they would like, you know, I learned to knit in hospital. They'd give you stuff to do, you know, keep you busy because you're ill. And every so often they'd come around with percussive instruments, little drum, a maraca, tambourine, and a huge sheet that they'd hang up. If it was a woman, actually, if she pointed to red, you'd hit the drum. Yellow would be a maraca, and, you know, it was all so exciting. Anyway, they gave me this drum, and then from then on, if they ever came, I wouldn't play in the band unless I had a drum.
Yeah.
Well, and I wanted to be a drummer from that day.
Right.
You know?
Liverpool itself, at that time, must have been an influence on you. With, at the same time as wanting to be a drummer, there was a surge that was happening with...
Well, there was a lot going on because it was a port.
Yeah.
And so all the guys in the Merchant Navy, all the neighborhood I lived in, every other house had someone in the Merchant Navy, and they were bringing all the records from America.
Right.
And so that was a huge influence. And to this day, Liverpool is like the city of country and western music. Right. You know, besides rock and roll and everything else, but in those days they were bringing in all these great rock records, and that's how we started to get our influence.
But your stepfather was quite influential in playing you certain
kinds. My stepdad Harry was great, because he did a thing which I actually copied him with my children, because I would be listening to like my music, you know, at the time, and he'd say things like, "Have you heard Sarah Vaughan? Have you heard Billy Eckstein?" You know, he'd never say, "That's rubbish, this is real music."
Yeah.
He'd always put it such a nice way. You know, he taught me all about big bands and, you know, big band singers. And I sort of play rock with a swing to it.
Yeah.
Because that's where I came in.
You told a story about a singer that came to Liverpool, and you realized, like, wow, it's like all these girls going crazy.
Oh, that was Johnny Ray.
Yeah.
Johnny Ray played Liverpool, and I love Johnny Ray, you know. And he was at this big fancy hotel, and he was sitting like three stories up, and he was throwing photos to the crowd below. And I thought, hey, that's pretty cool. That's where I want to go. But then we followed him, my friend and I, we followed him. We'd left the hotel, and we were like psycho fans. And we followed him to this restaurant. He went in this restaurant, and we were looking in the window. And he ordered his meal, and he was eating. And we thought, wow, he's eating like a real person. So I think these experiences have helped me understand the fans, you know.
But, you know, that area and that time and music at that time seemed to explode, not just for the Beatles, but...
Sure.
There seemed to be something in the water, as they say, and...
Well, I think the music explosion, I mean, I've always felt that it was because we were the first generation that didn't go into the army.
Right.
You know, I missed, it was called the call-up, by like 10 months. And so, you know, we were allowed as these teenagers not to be regimented.
Yeah.
And, you know... turn into these musicians because, you know, skiffle was around, Lonnie Donegan, of course, everybody's heard of. And the first band I was in, you were in if you had an instrument. It wasn't a requirement to be able to play. You could just have it. And I couldn't play, of course. No one could play when, you know, I got this kit of drums. I had no sense of time. You know, I was just hitting these things and going faster and faster and faster. And, you know, but that's how I started. Mm. It's just how it was. And the guitarist lived next door and he knew a couple of chords. And then my friend Roy played, it was called the T-Chess bass. Mm. And that's how I started.
So there's a lot of sort of controversy or people with different opinions about your entry from Rory Storm and into the Beatles. And just before, somebody was saying, oh yeah, no, Ringo never auditioned for the Beatles. He just went straight in. And I said, that's not exactly true. No. There wasn't exactly an audition, but you played for many months on and off with
them. I was playing with Rory, the biggest band in Liverpool at the time, and the Beatles were coming up. But anyway, we became friends because we played in Germany together. We were playing the same clubs in Liverpool, so we knew each other. And, you know, I was living the musician's life, and there was a knock on the door at 12 o'clock in the afternoon. And it was Brian Epstein saying, would you sit in with the Beatles, with John, Paul and George, because the drummer can't make it today. And so I got out of bed, he drove me in his big fancy car, it was great, to the cabin, and I played. And then several times after that, there'd be a knock on the door, be Brian saying, will you play today? And I'm sure. Then I was playing with Rory in this holiday camp, and I got a phone call from Brian on a Wednesday, and he said, will you join the Beatles? And I said, sure, when? He said, today. I said, no, I can't join today. I'm in a band here. These guys have a job, you know, I can't just dump them.
Yeah.
And so I said, you'll have to wait till Saturday.
Then you played that Saturday night.
I did.
In the cabin.
In the cabin.
And there was a lot of people booing and fighting.
Well, there was a whole fight went on because it was all right to jam, but then, you know, half of them, everybody knew me in Liverpool anyway. Most of them, it was okay, you were there now. But there was like, you know, a whole sort of fight scene went on because of Pete and because of me.
Right, yeah.
But anyway, I'm still there.
Yeah, and George got a black eye, right?
Well, George, yeah, we always say George 4 for me. Because someone would say, oh, what are you doing with him? And George was shouting back, you know. He wasn't always a guru. And this guy just whacked him, and he had this big black eye. And so he fought for Ringo.
What was it about the three guys in the Beatles that you thought this
the
a
music.
Good idea?
It was the only band I used to go and see because of the front line.
Right.
You know, to see John up there with his bandy legs, and, you know, and Paul's great voice, Joy. I mean, it was just, they were doing the best rendition of all the songs we were all doing in all our different bands.
But what do you think that they saw in you? Why were they homing in on you?
Well, I was probably the best drummer in Liverpool. I think it did help that we had played before and they knew that, you know, I could play their songs. I mean, I have one great moment playing with them for the first time, and they were doing rock and roll music. And, you know, just let me hear some of that rock and roll music, you know. Okay, and then in the middle it goes, don't get ahead and play your tango. And I went to the toms, and, you know, no one else, they were just like rocking through it all the time, but I was like playing the tom-tom parts,
right.
And John was going, don't get ahead in here, bum bum. Wow! Wow! He's playing the toms like it was a miracle, you know? And it was just, you know, the surprise.
But, well, John actually called you the heart of the Beatles.
I am.
And
what am I going to deny it, you know?
And, yeah, I can see many reasons why you would say that, but going into your drumming, I mean, going through Beatles tracks, I mean, you had to deal with such a mad amount of influences.
Yeah.
Especially as it developed. Suddenly George is, you know, playing Indian rhythms.
Yeah. He came with one of them, just let me jump in. He came with, like, oh, I've got this song, it's like 7.5 time. And, you know, I said, so? You know, I play 4/4 or 3/4. You know, so, you know, some sort of mad Indian thing. Anyway, we worked it out. Here Comes the Sun was the end result. But,
right.
You know, I had to, like, work out how, okay, well, you know, because I can't really count and play. So you have to find the feel, like you go, you know, da-di-di-da-di-di-da-di-di-diddly-diddly-dump. Okay, yeah. That's 7. Great.
You know, when you were first joining, they're different personalities, because they're so different personalities. You all are.
You know, we were very close. And, you know, the thing is, if the other two had a row, it would always get fixed up in my house.
Right.
It was like the neutral territory, you know, because you can't help it. You know, you're so close, and then the writing, and wanting it this way, and what's that. Mm. You know, the difference in the personnel, I always felt, was if John had written the song, you know, early on it was Paperback Writing and all that, all great songs and Want to Hold Your Hand and all that, but then it did separate. And John would look forward to what you wanted to bring to it.
Right.
Where Paul had more of a definite idea of what he wanted you to do.
Right.
That was the difference. And George, I mean, if you listen to his solos, he had such great soul. That's what came out of him, you know, and John, like the image situation, that's all it is the image came out as this hard guy, and Paul was, you know, the pleasant sort of guy. But, you know, they were all together, we saved each other's life.
Mm.
That was the deal.
Yeah.
You know, and we weren't always famous. We did spend a lot of time in a van, you know, traveling around the country together, and we couldn't afford hotels. We're staying in like these houses. And even after Shea Stadium, I mean, how big can you get? We were sharing a room. Now, you know, you have your own limo, you've got your own hotel, you've got 80 people looking after you. You know, we were lucky if we got a cup of tea.
It's been a hard day's night.
I don't know if Pitten and America knew how big the band was in Britain before you got on that plane to America.
Well, you know, we'd just come back from Sweden, where we were huge. If you're big in Sweden, you sell 6 records. Anyway, we were huge in Europe and England, and as we landed at Heathrow, all the kids were on the airport, you know, around the balconies and that, and Ed Sullivan actually was flying in from New York. And he just saw the crowd, and what's that for? And they booked us then.
Wow.
For like 6 months later, roughly.
Yeah.
And we had no records in America. We couldn't sell a record. And George actually came on holiday, and he was going into record stores and saying, have you got the record by the Beatles? And I was saying, no, never heard of them. And so when he came back, he said, oh, it's going to be really hard because they don't know about us. And between him coming back, and we released Wanna Hold Your Hand, I think it was, and Murray the K and Cousin Bruce, all these people in America, DJs and that, they'd all got behind the record, and we landed, and we were huge. I mean, it was like when we came in from Sweden, suddenly we get to Kennedy, and it was just crazy.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Beatles!
The first live gig was Washington. We came over, we did Ed Sullivan, which was live, but it was a TV.
Can I just jump in there? Ed Sullivan, 73 million people watched it.
Yeah.
And it was the lowest crime rate because of all the people watching
the channel. TV. How great is that?
How bloody amazing.
So what did you do?
Close your eyes and I'll kiss you. Tomorrow I'll miss you. Remember how
We got to Washington for this live gig, and the stage went round. Well, halfway through, my part of the stage wasn't turning. So, you know, she loves you, and the others are going, well, hey, how you doing? I'm over here. And I had to get off and try and turn it, you know, because we didn't have 100 roadies, so I'm like doing the business.
Okay. Washington. Oh, is that the place? I don't know. Washington. Oh, I'm just moving so fast.
I love those days. They were just so mad.
This one, which we recorded on an LP that we made, and that's English for album, an album that we made. And we'd like you, if you would, to sort of join in and clap your hands, you know, and stamp your feet.
There's a period when gigs just stopped. It was at Candlestick Park.
It was, we finished.
I mean, what was going on? Like, so you stopped gigging?
Well, we had a meeting. I mean, we were living together, so we just like discussed about, you know, I was like, it was hard because I couldn't do any fills anymore. If I didn't keep it, you know, I couldn't go at a tom or anything else because it would just go into.
They couldn't hear it, yeah.
We're like struggling to, you know, to get coherent together on stage. And so we thought, oh, this is just too crazy. You know, let's, you know, stop the tour and go in the studio. And that's what we did. And we spent a lot of time in the studio.
You know, quite a lot of musicians that if you stop playing live, it's kind of like a different life in a different world. It is
a different world because you're married, you've got kids.
Responsibilities.
You know, I mean, things change. Mm. That's life. And it was happening with us. So it was, like, you know, in a way, it wasn't so big as you're trying to make out. It was like a natural thing to get the music down.
Yeah.
You know, so the touring actually sort of got in the way a bit, you know.
Baby's good to me, you know she's happy. As can be, you know she's so
but were people on the road writing in notepads and...
Oh, writing the songs?
Room? Well, bits, you know, and...
Not really. Mainly they would... No, they would write them at home or that, you know, stuff like that. You know, it's like we had the day off and we'd go to the studio and then they'd have some part. Anyway, they were still writing together. I mean, we're talking about the Lennon and McCartney. Mm. And then it ended up where they weren't writing together, but they were writing full songs. Mm. And then it ended up... where they were just writing a verse or a chorus, and then we'd link it all together.
Right.
But as a writer myself, you know how hard it is to present your songs.
Oh, yeah. And well, can you imagine?
The first time I'd present a song, they'd all laugh because I'd just rewritten another song. I'd just written new words to some, you know, standard. And anyway, then I finally... did Don't Pass Me By, and got that, and Octopus's Garden. And,
yeah.
You know, so I would get one track. So it was, you know, things unfolded.
Going into the studio and playing, of course, it started to change as recording changed.
It did.
I mean, how did you take it being in this weird EMI, Abbey Road, sort of guys walking around in white laboratory coats.
I know.
What was that? Yeah.
Like? Well, what was great is that, you know, that the studio was like twice, three times bigger than this room, and we were huddled in a corner. But they had, the equipment they had was like, in a way, so bad that to get a good sound out of it, that's why the records hold up today. Mm. The work we put on into the sound.
Like putting the voice through a Leslie and all these experiments, which then...
Well, George was great because Martin, because he was open for that as well.
Yeah.
And when we went in, we were actually this pop band. Mm. Love Me Do. All the first songs were love, you know. And then we were touring. You know, we were actually turned into really bad musicians because the sound of the audience overpowered the amps we had. Now we could have gone out, of course, you know, they go out with a billion watts and speakers as big as your house.
Yeah.
We just had those little amps and the house PA.
Yeah.
So we decided to go into the studio. And that's when the experiments really started. Though they started a little on Revolver, you know, there was a few signs there as we went through our recording career. That's when it really took off.
One of the records that obviously changed musical history, Sergeant Pepper.
Picture yourself in a boat on a river with tangerine trees and marmalade skies.
It actually sounds so experimental, and it is, and it's got many strange effects and goes through all sorts of changes. And that on a four track. On a four track, which is like, if anybody knows about recording or making records, I mean, it's
well,
kind of
four tracks, or there's eight tracks, and now there's 72 tracks.
Yeah.
And which I feel with a band now, when they've got so many tracks, they don't play as a band. You know, people all like put the snare drum on its own, and you know, you'll just play one chord and then come back a week later and do the other one. You know, it's we just had to get it together because we only had so few tracks, and we were a band.
And around about that time, and a bit before that actually, and up through the Beatles, the critics started reviewing like pop music or popular music seriously. And I don't know whether it was that because of, you know, string arrangements by George Martin at first, or whether just by public demand. But that album, yeah, obviously blew so many people's minds. In England, there used to be this massive announcement before a Beatles single came out. The build-up was like insane, till everybody sort of dashed home and tuned in and turned it on, and then this sound came out, and the sound got more and more sort of magical and strange and odd.
Yeah.
And we all did, as we...
As we took drugs.
Exactly.
You can't say that in America, can you?
Yeah, we can.
Medication.
We all took it as a sign. Now they want us to take LSD. We all ran out trying to find it in Sunderland, which was very difficult.
I'm sure.
Well, this leads us to the trip to India, because George brought in a sound from India and introduced it to the Beatles, but it also to the world. That sort of hinted at this kind of, for some reason, conjured up some psychedelic, hallucinogenic feeling.
It was a partnership.
Yeah.
LSD and India.
That's right. So what was it like sort of going to India at that point?
We were having my second son at the time, and I was at the hospital, and there was a message from George, we've met this guy, and it was the Maharishi. So that's how it started. We went to India, and being at the ashram with Maharishi, and there was a lot, Donovan was there, or, you know, it was like rock and roll ashram. But it was a great experience, and through meditation he gave me my mantra, and it's something I've always felt. You can take the car, you can take the house or whatever, but the mantra is mine, you know what I mean? It's in my soul. It's something you can't lose.
I like to talk a bit about, you know, drumming.
Drumming, yeah, well, we got the drums there. Let's light action. What are we going to do?
Well, I just think that some of your drum patterns, you know, like this particular song, when I was listening to radio, I think I mentioned before, and Ticket to Ride came on the radio.
Yeah.
The drum pattern, I immediately noticed, wasn't a straightforward drum pattern.
And how does it go? Hang on a minute there.
A bit like...
Yeah. Okay, was that it?
Well, there's one very interesting...
It was pretty close.
There was one very interesting thing, which the second downbeat.
Yeah.
And I think it's because of the shoulder.
I play with my shoulder, you see, so it's like...
Exactly.
You know, but... yeah, even this. Whoa!
Exactly, and that second downbeat is slightly late,
which, yeah.
Whenever I've tried to get drummers to play with me that track, they never seem to get that lateness, and it's to do with the swing, isn't it?
It is to do with the swing, or as we keep mentioning, medication.
let's jump in another one.
Yeah.
Here's another one that is...
great guitar, look at that.
Thank you very much. A great one, which... I don't think I've ever found a drummer to play this one right, and you can probably explain why, because it's a very unusual.
Well, when you tell me what it is, I might be
able to... I'm not going to tell, I'm just going to play the beginning.
You're going to surprise me. Into fours, then.
Yeah, such a... You recognise it, of course.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, shake it off. I keep going to hit that now. It's been so long. The interesting thing with this pattern is that it's actually the bass that opens that song.
Yeah.
And, you know, John's words. You know, that's the intro. There's no, like, real verse or anything.
Yeah.
And so we're sitting around, and it was just like playing with what he was saying and with what the bass line was doing. Mm. And, you know, trying to find sort of an interesting piece. Because besides this part that comes in several times, the rest of it is just like... It's just like fours, you know what I mean? It's real easy.
Yeah.
But why we got to this is because, you see, I'm left-handed and I'm playing a right-handed kit. If there's any drummers in here, see, they usually go, you know, they go round the drum this way. Well, I can't do that. See, I can't go... So I have to get this hand down to roll. So that's why everyone thought, wow, he's a genius, but all he's doing is trying to play backwards. You know, so he goes... So it comes around this way, and all my fills, which, you know... You know, they don't come in fast. There's always a break because I have to get this hand ready. So it's like... and get back, you know what I'm saying? So it's like one of those mad accidents. You can't learn it. I was left-handed. My grandmother didn't like that. She made me go right-handed. And so I have a right-handed kit, but actually I'm a left-handed player.
Wow.
I hope that answers all your questions. Hope you're getting this, Brent.
Can you just play Back Off Boogaloo a sec?
Ah, yeah. Why we have that drum pattern? Great. is because he said, you know, give it that sort of bass. I'm like, and I can't do that and this. You know, I can't do them both together, so I just sort of cheated. Mm. So, okay, 2, 3, 4. And so that's how it came to be done on the snare drum, because I couldn't just play that bass drum pattern.
Well,
so it's magic.
It's magic. Well, I think...
You know, I'd like to sit here and tell everyone, oh, yeah, you know, it took me an hour and... or 3 days to seriously think out this pattern. Mm. But actually, it happens at the time, or for me, you know, I can't struggle like that.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It comes naturally, or it doesn't come at all.
Yeah. Or it don't come easy.
Or it don't come easy.
The point where I'm going to bring out my black box.
Okay.
And without you having a clue, I'm going to give you a brief look at an album cover and you say the first thing that comes into your head.
Yeah. Ah, loved it. Chuck Berry, great.
A big influence?
He was, actually. His sound was so great and, you know, his songs were like poems and, you know, high little schoolgirl, who could doubt that? Ah, the genius of Ray Charles, yeah, incredible. Ray Charles, I have the best Ray Charles collection because when I played Germany, they used to keep the actual records in the covers. And so we'd go shopping. Yeah, thanks a lot.
Here's a good one for you.
Yeah, that's great. I just don't like my hair on that one, but that was the start of, you know, the whole thing in mono. How great.
Where was that?
That was in Abbey Road, EMI house or whatever it was called. We're looking over the bent balcony.
There's some surprises in here. Here's one that...
Oh, yeah, the Ringo album. Look at all those guys that were on it. I mean, it was so great. The band's on it, Dr. John's on it. And it was an accident, really. That's what I love about our business, because I was going to Nashville to do the Grammys. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Harry Nilsson was a friend of mine. So I called Richard Perry. We're all going to be in Nashville. Why don't we make an album? He said, why don't we do it in L.A.? Mm-hmm. And that's how we got all those great people.
Right, and... obviously spawned some
massive... And it was the biggest Beatle boy seller at the time.
That's right,
yes. Everyone was shocked. Oh, Ringo, sell him more than everybody.
Yeah.
And it was a great experience because by accident, John came into town.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I wanted a song, so he'd written a song. And George came into town a little later. I was still making the album. So we had him, and he'd written a song, Sail Away Raymond. And then I thought, well, I'm not going to leave Paul out, so I called Paul, and we went to England.
So John wrote, I'm the greatest.
I'm the greatest.
And Paul, George wrote Photograph.
Well, no, I wrote Photograph, and George...
Oh, that's right.
See, what I used to do, I was great at a verse and a chorus, or two verses and a chorus. I could never, like, finish them.
Mm-hmm.
So my early records were produced by George because he would round them off for me, and I would play three chords, that's all I can play.
Mm-hmm.
Then I would give them to him, and he'd put in the passing chords, and mm-hmm. there'd be, like, 10 chords, and I'd be like a genius.
Mm-hmm.
So, and that's how it happened. But the other thing with George was so great because, you know, he was trying to, like, throw in every, you know, like, say it was photographed, I don't see your face, oh Krishna. I said, no, I'm not singing Krishna. you know, reminds me of, oh Lord, no, I'm not singing about that. So we used to have great fights, but now I'll sing about God and Krishna the first chance I get.
Yeah, it's got all three of the Beatles on the
it
album,
is.
And
yeah.
Smash Hits.
Oh, yeah. Sentimental Dream, that's where we used to live, down there, and this was the pub on the corner. But when the Beatles broke up, you know, I went and sat in the garden, and what to do now, we've all agreed it's over, and, you know, it didn't end up so great anyway.
Mm.
And so these were all the songs that I'd learnt in that house and houses like that.
Yeah.
They're all standards.
And you got all your family in the window.
And I put the family in the window, but the songs themselves, and I did it with George Martin and Quincy Jones did an arrangement, all these people came out, it was great. Because, you know, you think, I'm going back to the songs I heard as a kid.
Yeah.
Because in our house, if there was a party, everybody had to sing something. You all had to have your song, and my auntie, you know, for the 20 years I lived there, sang the same song. My mother sang the same song.
Mm.
My stepdad, that old Black Magic, yeah. you know, that was his song. And so I it was like a homage to them, really, and something to do.
Great. Okay. The obvious.
Oh, yeah. You know, this is so great. I mean, the album is good, but the cover is so great because the Beatles, we always sat around the studio with these big ideas. Now we're going to do the cover and we're going to go to Egypt or we're going into some volcano and we're going to do this big thing and then, oh sod it, let's just walk across the road. you know, and that's what we did. You know what I mean? It always came, you know, after these big ideas, oh well, what, get in a plane, pack a bag, oh God, let's just walk over there. You know? And it's like, oh, look at what they thought of.
That's brilliant.
Ah, T-Rex, yeah, Mark Boland. He was a really good friend of mine, and actually I wrote Back Off Boogaloo because of him. Mm. Because he spoke like that. Mm. You know, oh, Back Off Ringo, and oh, Boogaloo. And so anyway, I became friends with him, and he came to dinner one night, and he was talking about Back Off Boogaloo, so I went to bed. And you know that, like, there's that zone just before you go off, and I could hear, Back Off Boogaloo, I said, Back Off, and I'm like, Back Off. I said, oh, God, I'm getting a song here. And I got out of bed, I ran downstairs, because I have no memory. I had none then, I have none now. And I was looking for a tape to put it on. I had all this equipment, none of it. It was all broken, there was no batteries. And the drag was, it was turning into Mac the Knife. Back Off the Shark. No, 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 Back Off. Anyway, I ravaged one of the kids' toys and took the batteries, put it in the tape.
Very good, very good.
And this again, like, let's do the big cover, the big photo. And as we were, it was being projected onto a piece of cardboard. And as it was being projected, the cardboard fell back. And that's what gives it that weird thing. I mean, you know, people say, oh, they must have spent $1 million on that. It's a piece of cardboard that was falling over. And, oh, wow. Hey, why don't I direct some of the answers over this way? You know? These look like your family members you're not really close to.
What was your favorite Beatles song?
My favorite Beatles song? You know, being on so many. Mm-hmm. That's always a difficult question. Mm. I mean, there's several reasons for, you know, liking each one, really. I mean, you know, just I've always said Rain, you know, because then it just got it out the way. What's your favorite Beatles? Yeah, Rain. Mm. It is one of my favorites. And the drumming is one of my, you know, what I did on that record was I always felt different to how I'd played before. Mm. But, you know, I love Do It in the Road. And that was just Paul and I did the original track. We were waiting for John to do something in one city. We just went in the cupboard next door and did it.
Why don't we do it in the road? Why don't we do it in the road?
Summer of 68, in the middle of recording the White Album.
Yeah.
What was the atmosphere and the vibe?
Well, the vibe was hell. I mean, in my head, it was... I felt that, you know, I wasn't part of it. I wasn't playing good. I had all these thoughts and I was miserable. So I thought, well, I'll sort this out. So anyway, I went round to talk to John, who was, we were in London at the time and he was in this apartment of mine. and I knocked on the door, hey, John, yeah, and I, come here. I said, look, you know, I feel you three are so close. You know, and I'm out of it. You know, I don't feel part of it. And he said, I thought it was you three. So I thought, oh, God. So I went over to Paul's and I said the same thing. You know, you three are so close. I don't feel like connected. He said, I thought it was you three. So I left the band and went on holiday to Sardinia. And I was getting these telegrams, come on home. And anyway, my head calmed down, and I went back, and I went to Abbey Road, and George had decked the whole place out with flowers.
Right.
And that's, we got back into recording, but it was just one of those moments, and, you know, it's like I'd been in the band for 4 years then, or 6 years, and...
it's amazing that, see, 6 years, and to a lot of bands, that's like, you know, a couple of albums and a few, but all that stuff happened.
But I think the more interest was everybody was feeling the same. You know, it was like just a moment in time of four people's lives.
They had great tracks on the album.
It did. I loved the White Album. I felt we were getting back to being a band.
Yeah.
You know, there's a lot of bandy tracks. And also, Your Blues was great because we went into a room as big as this chair. And there's no separation. We were just being, like I was talking to the audience, you know, in these clubs. So we were just like looking at each other again, yeah. You know.
During that period, there was all different influences coming in, as you know, drugs and different wives,
music.
Women,
yeah.
First stuff. How did all that end up in the mix, or was it involved in the mix of the breakdown, or it was just?
No, I don't think that. It was just that musically, I didn't feel great. You know what I mean? I was like lost in a way, and I think it was, you know, it was all down to my state of mind at the time. Mm-hmm. No, I don't think it was because one of us had changed partners.
So,
which was very interesting, but, you know, we were still a band. But, you know, I still believe that, you know, the lifespan of any band really is like 8 years. Mm. Because, you know, by then, you know, you were 20 when you started, you know, in early 20s, you're energized and... And then suddenly you're 30 and, you know, I want to play the blues.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Oh, yeah, fine, let's go. Okay. Blues.
Well, it must have felt like that when you got back together and played on that infamous and famous rooftop concert.
It
which
did.
Is amazing, again, in the love.
Well, that was another situation. Let's finish this concert in... Hawaii or, you know, Morocco, oh, let's do it on the roof. You know, that's how it turned out. Let's go on the roof. I mean, we're here, let's go.
Don't let me down.
Audience was so small, there was a couple of policemen trying to take the amps out, and Yoko and Maureen and people on other roofs looking at us.
Yeah.
And then Savile Row, like full of people looking up, couldn't see us but could hear it. And Billy Preston, God rest his soul, how great is that? Was damp and, you know,
yeah,
rainy. But it didn't matter, you know, when you're playing, it's like, oh, well, let's go.
Yeah. So when the Abbey Road album was actually being recorded, how aware of you were you of that? This is like...
Oh, we were breaking up then.
Coming to an end.
Yeah, it was coming to an end, and it was, you know, but it never came to an end after the... As soon as the counting came in, we were together. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? One, two, three, four. Oh, boom, boom, down. You know, we all did it. But then, you know, as soon as the take ended, you bastard! not quite that, but you know what I mean? The life together had really disintegrated, you know, it was really breaking up, but we were still musicians and we still put on 100%.
Yeah, it's a bit...
But the songs were short.
Yeah. You
know? Yeah. Well, that's when, you know, John would only write a verse and, you know, Paul would have something else and yeah. We'd string it all together. You know, I keep calling it like the B-side of the album.
Yeah.
You know, with Polythene Palm and Bathroom Window and all that. That's my favorite
section. She came through the bathroom window, it's amazing.
Yeah.
She came in through the bathroom window. Protected by a silver spoon.
Lots of people's favorite song actually is Octopus's Garden, which you
which I wrote.
But I don't know what it's really about, because I'm sure.
Well, the Octopus's Garden is very simple because when we had this breakup.
Yeah.
And I left and I went to Sardinia. We had a house on the beach, it was very nice. It was very quiet because it was out of the tourist season. And Peter Sellers had a boat and he lent me his boat and a yacht, they like to call it. But anyway, we're on this yacht and we ordered like lunch, and they prepared lunch and brought it on the table, and it was French fries and this weird stuff. I said, what the hell is that? He said, oh, it's the octopuses.
Octopus? We don't eat damn octopus. Where's the fish?
I never had octopus before. And so anyway, I was talking to the captain about octopus, and he was telling me this story. He said, you know, octopus, when they're underneath, they build gardens, and they have a cave, and they go around the seabed picking up shiny things and, like, putting it in front of them. Well, you know, with the medication, it was like, wow, God, wow. You know? You know, it was like the best thing I ever heard. And so I had a guitar with me, and in my three chords, I'd like, because, you know, my head was exploding, so it was a, it actually meant I'd like to be under the sea in an octopus's garden.
Yeah.
In a nice way, you know, in the garden, because it was just hell in here at the time. So, I wrote as much as I could. Mm. I took it back to George, and who, you know, transposed some of the chords, and I'd like to be in Krishna's garden. No, Krishna! So it was because of that. It was because I'd left the band, I'd gone on holiday, I was a bit brain damaged, and I just thought how beautiful this octopuses do this, you know.
We would sing and dance around because we know we can't be found. I'd like to be under the sea.
Well, this brings me around to the other day we were talking, and what happened to those great sort of sessions where people played with each other and created, you know,
music
yeah. basically, a piece of art.
Yeah.
And I think that's what Ringo continues to do. And when he goes and plays with Ringo Starr and the All-Stars and his friends, and when he rings up people and say, hey, do you want to come around to play? I think it's great, you know, that throughout a career that's lasted as long as you have, that you still have that. You want to make music, you want to write songs, you want to play with people. And for me, it's very inspiring. So I'd just like to say that.
Well, I'm glad. Yeah. Also, you know, making music, the four boys from Liverpool were like close together in this little space. Mm. And then suddenly, as the years went on, like, you know, the drums were all screened off, and, you know, there was big glass between everybody, there was no contact. Yeah. And so, for the last 9-10 years, every track I've done it in a room, and you're no further than that. I'm on the drums, you're there, the bass player's here, you're on harmonica. Because you need to be together. And now with modern techniques, you can direct inject. The drums are always live. I play, you get what you get. And everyone's inject. But I want to see your sweat, and I want to see, is it a verse, is it a chorus, where are we going, you know?
Yeah.
It's part of it.
Yeah.
It's part of the magic of playing with the people.
Earlier on, we talked about, you know, where Ringo was born, where he came from, and basically, I put a challenge to Ringo a few weeks ago.
Dave and I and this other partner, we were writing songs for my new CD. Anyway, we asked Dave to play guitar on something. He asked us to do this. So anyway, we'd met up at a studio and things like that. And then I thought, well, come on over and let's write a song. So
let's demonstrate being as out. Let's try this, shall we? Is this on?
Let's try it. Okay. Was a sailor first, I sailed the sea. Then I got a job in a factory. Played Butlin's camp with my friend Rory. It was good for him, it was great for me. Liverpool, I left you, said goodbye to Madryn Street. I had to follow my heart, and I never missed a beat. Destiny was calling, I just had to leave this town. Liverpool, I left you, but I never let you down.
Red lights were on, with George and Paul and my friend John. We rocked all night, we all looked up. We didn't have much, but we had enough. Liverpool, I left you, said goodbye to Madryn Street. I always thought
fool.